Good morning. Welcome to Redeemer Lutheran Church and our worship service this morning as we gather together around Word and Sacrament to receive the forgiveness of sins that the Lord has so richly provided us through his life and through his death and through his resurrection. Today our focus is on the transfiguration of our Savior, that glorious moment when Peter, James, and John saw their Savior in his glory, and yet God the Father turned their attention to Jesus' word when he said, "Listen to him." We begin our service this morning by singing hymn number 225. May God bless your worship today. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. Let us bow before the Lord and confess our sins. Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. I ask each of you, in the presence of God who searches the heart, do you confess that you have sinned, and do you repent of your sins?
I do.
Do you believe that Jesus Christ has redeemed you from all your sins, and do you desire forgiveness in his name?
I do.
Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God to all of you. And in the stead and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May he comfort your heart with his absolution and strengthen you by his sacraments, that your joy may be full. Peace be with you. The lightnings lit up the world. The earth trembled and shook. How lovely is your tabernacle, O Lord of hosts. Glory be to God on high. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, who through the transfiguration of your Son revealed his glory to the three on the mountaintop, reveal your glory to us through your spoken word, so that we may have comfort and strength in life and in death. We pray this in the name of our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. The first lesson for today is recorded in Isaiah chapter 61, verses 10 and 11. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with a robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom decks himself like a priest with a beautiful headdress, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its sprouts, and as a garden causes what is sown to sprout up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to sprout up before all nations. The word of the Lord. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They will still be praising you. O God, behold our shield, and look upon the face of your anointed. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness.
For the Lord God has sent you shield.
The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. Our epistle reading is recorded in 2 Peter in chapter 1, beginning at verse 16. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased," we ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven, and we were with him on the holy mountain. And we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Knowing this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation, for no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord. Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is recorded in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 17, beginning at verse 1. The Gospel reading will also serve as our sermon text today. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with them. And Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make 3 tents here, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah." He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were afraid. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Rise and have no fear." And when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, "Tell no one the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead." Here ends the Holy Gospel. We unite in confessing our Christian faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. He shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated as we continue with the chief hymn of the day, hymn number 224. Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of God for this morning is the account of the Transfiguration from Matthew's Gospel, which I read earlier. Dear friends of our Savior, who do the people say that I am? The disciples answered that question of Jesus by saying, well, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, some Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. Jesus follows up with a very direct question, but who do you say that I am? Peter immediately said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Peter answered the question correctly. Immediately, Jesus told his disciples that he would have to suffer under the chief priests, scribes, and elders, be executed, and rise again the third day. Peter, who just confessed that Jesus is a Christ, the Son of the living God, pulled the Savior aside and said, "No, may it never happen. That isn't going to happen to you." He could not wrap his head around the thought that the Son of the living God would have to suffer and die under execution. Jesus' follow-up statement was just as shocking to the disciples. "If anyone would follow me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." I'm sure the disciples were thinking self-denial, a personal cross. Lord, that is not what we signed up for. The disciples heard Jesus say that he would suffer and be killed, but the resurrection sort of went over their head and out of their minds. They heard self-denial, a personal cross, but sort of let follow him, follow Jesus, go by the wayside. In light of this exchange of words and questions and answers and Jesus' proclamations, the disciples needed some encouragement. And that encouragement would come less than a week later. That encouragement came at the Lord's Transfiguration. The specific encouragement that the Transfiguration holds out to all of Jesus' disciples is this: since Jesus is God's Son, listen to him. The facts are quite simple. 6 days after that exchange, Jesus took three of his disciples on the top of an unidentified mountain. The three were Peter, James, and John. Jesus frequently took those three along with him when something extraordinary was about to happen. And there, in the simplest of words, we are told that Jesus was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes were as bright as light. If you and I were to write an account of what Peter, James, and John saw on the Mount of Transfiguration, we would probably take a whole chapter of the Bible, or maybe even a whole book of the Bible. We'd be in every detail that we saw and write down exactly our feelings about it. But the Holy Spirit only inspires what he wants you to know about what happened on the mountaintop. And very simply put, there Jesus was transfigured before them. The word transfigure means to transform into something more beautiful or more elevated than before. He who walked on the face of this earth, showing his humanity to all mankind, but obscuring that divine glory that is his by divine right, showed that divine glory to Peter, James, and John. The Holy Spirit himself has a hard time finding the right words to describe the grandeur, that extra beauty, and that highly elevated state that Jesus was in on the Mount of Transfiguration. Matthew told us his face shone like the sun and his clothes were as white as light. Mark tells us his clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone on earth could bleach them. Luke tells us the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning. John doesn't record the transfiguration of Jesus, but he does tell us this: we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Peter, the only one of the three disciples on the mountaintop who records anything about the transfiguration, tells us that we were eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received honor and glory from his Father. That divine nature, so hidden in his humanity, shine forth. This was a demonstration of Jesus' divine glory. Right after that, we are told that two people appeared seemingly out of nowhere. They were identified as Moses and Elijah from the Old Testament. They were standing there in the kind of glory that you and I will share with them through all eternity as redeemed, forgiven, and saved children of God. And no sooner had they appeared than a cloud enveloped the mountain, and a voice came from the middle of the cloud and said of Jesus, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." It wasn't until the cloud came and the voice of the Father was heard that Peter, James, and John were terrified. Peter's first response was, "Lord, it's great to be here. It's good for us to be here with you, the transfigured Savior, and with Moses and Elijah in their glory." But he had hardly gotten those words out of his mouth when the cloud appears and the voice comes. And when they hear the voice of the Heavenly Father, we are told they fell face down onto the ground, and they were terrified. Peter, James, and John were terrified at the vision of transfiguration. They were filled with fear when they saw their Lord in his full glory and heard his Father identify Jesus as his Son. They were filled with fear at this demonstration of Jesus' divine glory. And I think you and I can understand, because someplace rattling around in our brains is a verse that St. Paul said that we've all memorized at one time or another: "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Those words are hard enough to read in the Bible. They're defeating when we hear them in a sermon. But if we were to have a glimpse of Jesus and all his glory next to us in our humanity, in our sinfulness, we would have to confess that we fall short of the glory of God. Think of Isaiah, who saw himself standing before the throne of God in heaven. "Woe is me," he said, "I'm lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people with unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." The Lord has told us what he expects of us. In the Old Testament, the Lord said, "Be holy, because I am holy." Jesus leaves no doubt of God's expectations of us in the New Testament. "Be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect." Paul lays before us, as the ideal Christian life, the glory of God. It takes just one little glimpse of the glory of God, and to draw the conclusion, if that is God's expectation of me, I am an utter failure. I look at myself. I see guilt. I don't see glory. I look at myself. And I think, I have not only fallen short of the glory of God with all mankind, but I, as well as all mankind, have fallen far short of the glory of God. To fall short of the glory of God is an understatement. There is such a gap between me and the Lord's glory that it seems to be insurmountable. Maybe I can sense a bit of the glory of heaven when I see Moses and Elijah there in their glory and know what we will all have as believers in heaven someday. But today, in my earthly life, I simply don't see it because I'm a sinner. I stand there with Isaiah and say, "Woe is me, I am lost. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people with unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Like Isaiah, standing in the presence of the glory of God, we say, "I am lost." And we would be lost. All of us would be lost. You would be lost. I would be lost. Were it not for what the Father in heaven tells Peter, James, and John. He says, "Listen to him. Listen to Jesus." No one less than God the Father himself diverts our attention away from the vision on the mountaintop. No one less than God the Father diverts our attention away from the Lord in his transfiguration. No one less than God the Father diverts our attention from that place where we would probably say with Peter, "Lord, it's good for us to be here," and turns our attention to the message of Jesus, to the Word of the living God, to the pages of the Holy Bible. Listen to him. Jesus, 6 days earlier, had told his disciples, after they confessed that he was the Son of the living God, that he had to suffer under the elders, chief priests, and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day rise again. Even though the disciples did not realize it at the time, Jesus was teaching them the heart and core of the message of the Bible. He was teaching them the soul of what the Scriptures have to say to you. He was teaching the reason why he came into this world to be our Savior. He came to suffer under Pontius Pilate, to be crucified, dead, and buried, and on the third day rise again from the dead. The Father in heaven says, "Listen to Jesus. Listen to that message of Jesus." And to bring out the impact of that, Luke tells us something about the transfiguration of Jesus that Matthew doesn't. He gives us a little snippet of the conversation that Jesus had with Moses and Elijah. Luke tells us that they spoke about the departure or the decease that Jesus would make in Jerusalem. Jesus was talking to Moses and Elijah about his upcoming death as a payment for the sins of the world. And Peter, James, and John had the privilege of listening to that message that Jesus was discussing with these two saints of old. And Peter, in his letter, which we read earlier, the only one of those three disciples on the Mount of Transfiguration to write down anything about it, tells us this: "We were eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received power and glory." But then he immediately tells us, "But we have the prophetic word made more certain, to which you do well to take heed, as to a lamp that's shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your heart. Notice how Peter, too, who experienced the vision on the Mount of Transfiguration, immediately turns our attention away from that vision of glory to the pages of the Holy Bible, even emphasizing that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation, for no prophecy came into existence by the will of man, but holy men spoke from God as they were carried along or moved by the Holy Spirit. The message that is given here is don't try to find glory here in this world without the cross. Don't try to find glory in heaven without the message of the Holy Scriptures. Listen to Jesus. Listen to his word in the Bible. You know what it says in many, many different places. Jesus came to be our Savior. He came to wash away our sins with his blood. He came to answer that question, and it's answered in the Bible, how someone who is so far short of the glory of God in this life can have the glory that Moses and Elijah had in heaven. It is through that gospel message of the forgiveness of sins purchased on the cross that you and I have that hope, that confidence, and that assurance. For you see, when Jesus came into this world to suffer and die for us, he came to suffer for our sins, and he came to die our death. And because Jesus suffered for our sins, and because he was executed in place of us and died the death that God would have required of us, you and I have that hope of glory that he holds before us. Think of the beautiful words that the Bible says. He was bruised for our iniquity. He was crushed for our transgressions. The Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He has canceled the record of debt that stood against us with all its legal demands. He put this aside, nailing it to the cross. Listen to him. And know as well that we listen not only to that message of the sufferings and death of our Savior, but to the message of his resurrection. In Jesus' resurrection, we see not only the possibility, but the assurance that you and I will also rise from the dead. Because in the resurrection of Jesus, we can see he who had a human nature just like ours was able to be raised from the dead. Our Savior himself tells us, because I live, you too shall live. And so we are connected not only to the cross of Christ, but to the empty tomb, not only to his death, but to his resurrection, not only to the forgiveness of sins, but to be raised, reunited with our soul, and live with our God forever in heaven in glory. Know that as we listen to Jesus, there's a call for self-denial, and there is a cross to bear. In turning away from any other way to heaven, in turning away from any other message that can lead us to eternal life, in turning away from any other gospel, any other good news, to the one that's in the Bible, we will deny ourselves. And on top of that list, I'm going to deny that any of my good works has anything at all to do with getting me to heaven. I need to deny that. Because if Jesus did all of that, what good can I add to what the Savior has done? Nothing. And I will deny everything in this life to keep that pearl of great price. If this is the only way for me to get to heaven, I want to guard and protect it with everything I have, making every sacrifice I need to keep it in my heart. And I will gladly bear the cross that it brings into my life. The gospel is good news. It's the greatest news in the world, and it shows us that Jesus is the only way to glory in heaven. And the world hates it. The world hates that message with all its might. The world doesn't want to be told it can offer nothing. The world doesn't want to be told it needs a Savior. The world doesn't want to be told it needs to deal with sin. And because the world hates the message, it hates the messengers, of course, but it also hates everybody that espouses it. And that's the cross that we bear in this world. Everything that comes from the hatred of Jesus and the gospel, we bear on a daily basis because we listen to him. But the truth of the Transfiguration stands today as it has always stood from the day Jesus was transfigured before his disciples. Since Jesus is God's Son, listen to him. Amen. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand for prayer. Heavenly Father, who on the mountain revealed Jesus Christ in his unveiled divine majesty, and by wonderful testimony out of the cloud declared him your Son, whom you love, help us always to believe and confess that Jesus is God to the glory of your name. In commanding us to hear your Son, you have placed your divine blessing on all that he has spoken. Grant us grace to hear his wonderful words of salvation with steadfast faith, so that we do not dread his final coming or fear his judgment. Gracious Father, to know Christ by faith is to know your love, to possess your forgiveness, and to share with the saints the hope of everlasting life. We thank you for giving us this knowledge and faith. Lord Jesus Christ, though glorified in the mountain before witnesses, you nevertheless humbled yourself even to the death on the cross for our transgressions. Make us willing to suffer for you, to risk all that we have, even our lives, in order that we might better confess your name and teach your gospel to others. Precious Savior, your appearing in glory in the company of Moses and Elijah, and speaking to them of your approaching death, proves that the prophet's words foretelling a Savior from sin are fulfilled in you. The apostles too were eyewitnesses of your glory and have declared the same before the world. Teach us to heed the testimony of the prophets and apostles given in Holy Scripture, that we may never fail to worship you as Savior of sinners and Lord of all. Those on the mountain were happy to see your glory for even a passing moment. How blessed all of us will be to spend eternity with you in heaven. Graciously grant, therefore, eternal life to us, forgiving our sins, erasing our doubts, destroying all confidence in our own merit, and increasing and sustaining our trust in you through your word of truth. Comfort us with a bright hope of your coming. Care for our needs and preserve us from all things physical and spiritual that may bring us harm. Of your rich grace and endless mercy, we ask these things. Amen. We continue with the order of communion on page 7 in our worship folder. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. We continue with the distribution of the Lord's Supper. Please come forward at this time with about 6 on each side of the aisle.
body and blood of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve him, the true faith unto life everlasting. Rejoice, your sins are forgiven. Depart in peace. Amen. Amen.
Please stand.
Thank you.
O give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through these salutary gifts. And we beseech you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through them in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one true God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Please be seated for our closing hymn, hymn number 55. Welcome again to our worship service here at Redeemer Lutheran Church. It is good for us to be here in God's house to hear his word, and it was good for me to be here with you as well. Pastor Dan Basil will be having the Bible class this morning for a presentation from the ELS, so please stay for that as well. There's time for some refreshments following. Pray that the message of the Lord's Transfiguration sustains your faith this day and through the coming week until you gather here in God's house again.